Go and grab your Bible. If you have it, hopefully you're in the habit now because I'm asking you every single week and I'm going to keep asking you. Grab your Bible, grab an app. If you have a phone, that is great as well. Really easy to just go click on the book of the Bible and the chapter and the verse and it'll take you right there. But if you have a hard copy, that's fine too. You can go to the table of contents and look up the book of 1 Corinthians. We're going to be looking at chapter 11, starting at verse 17 this morning. Chapter 11, verse 17 this morning. And as you know, we've been working our way through the book of 1 Corinthians. And I have to say, it has been so beneficial and eye-opening, even for me, not even for me as though like, wow, you know, but it has been for me to read through and talk about this book of the Bible and a book of the Bible like this in its entirety. And I hope you feel the same way. See, the thing about books like 1 Corinthians is that they're copies of letters that were written during the first century. And they were written by people who knew Jesus personally to communities of faith scattered around the Mediterranean or Greco-Roman world. And they weren't just casual notes, written and dropped in the mail to say hello or, you know, wish you well or whatever that might be. They had a purpose. And often the purpose of these letters was to address an issue or issues in the church and call people in the church to reorient their lives according to the truth that God had provided in Christ. It was for their good. I mean, people would get off track, people would become influenced by culture, and that would lead to destruction in their lives and in their relationships. And, you know, as people who had taken the message of God's love and truth to these cities, people like Paul would write to help people stay on track and remember what life is all about in Christ, okay? And so these letters are helpful for us because, as I said before, human nature is the same. Human nature is the same. It's consistent. And even though cultures change, people's hearts and the human heart is the same, okay? And so that's why there's a benefit of us taking a look at that or look at these passages and applying them to our lives, okay? So the church in Corinth, they had been greatly influenced by the culture around them. This is one of the issues that Paul was addressing. The people in the city of Corinth and ancient Greek culture in general, they held wisdom in the highest regard. In fact, they worshiped it. And as we said last week, the word philosophy, which was used by Plato, it comes from the Greek word philo or philo for love and sophia, meaning wisdom. And so it literally is defined as the love of wisdom, not to be confused with phyllo pastry, which is used in Greek cooking, which is also great. It's delicious, but it's not something to worship as well. And my wife is groaning off to the side right now, but that's okay. Anyways, in the search for wisdom or enlightenment, people would elevate and embrace teachings of individuals who said things that appeared to be wise and well-spoken. TED Talks, anyone? All right, I mean, the things we do today, they're influenced by, you know, generations from long ago. And the culture outside of the church had influenced the culture inside the church. And based on the book of 1 Corinthians, we know that people in the church had begun to elevate and esteem certain church leaders over others based on the eloquence of their speech and the appearance of wisdom in their teaching. And this led to a number of problems in the church. People who felt that they had obtained higher knowledge considered themselves superior to others in the church. And the church was actually splitting apart because of that. Furthermore, while they had held on to these ideas, which had the appearance of wisdom, what they had embraced was only human logic, which was really a distortion of godly truth, which perpetuated their self-indulgent and destructive ways, which were really no different than the world around them. And these were things that God had given his son to save them from. So some of the examples that we've looked at so far, examples of this human knowledge included the belief that sexuality should be avoided in marriage, yet it resulted in sexual indulgence outside of marriage. Other beliefs were used to excuse a lack of faithfulness in marriage or really in any situation in life, giving people the liberty to move on as their desires suited them, as opposed to being committed and diligent, hardworking, or faithful. And what it comes down to is this, that it is human nature to embrace manipulations of truth which have the appearance of wisdom yet serve our self-interests. It's human nature. It's human nature. Even when we're confronted with truth, even when God provides truth for us, it's human nature to manipulate or to embrace manipulations of truth that serve our self-interests, because we are by nature self-interested people. And so if there's someone who can take what God has provided for us and twist it so that it serves our desires, then a lot of people just decide that that's the best of both worlds. It has the appearance of wisdom, it has the appearance of spirituality, yet it serves our self-interest. And people are no different today. It's human nature. And so we really need to be careful about that. And we need letters like this one that bring us back to godly truth, which has been provided for us in Christ and which gives us life, okay? So today we're gonna look at another example in the life of the Corinthian church that didn't line up with the gospel. And what you're gonna see in the next few chapters is how Paul is moving them from being people who have embraced human wisdom that promotes self-centered living and division to being people who embrace godly truth, which promotes selfless living and results in unity. Paul is leading them to unity in Christ, okay? And that's the context, the broader picture of where things are heading. So let's look at 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 17. But before we read that verse, why don't we pray? Okay, Heavenly Father, we thank you so much that we can gather together online, that we have that opportunity, that that's a possibility for us, God, even though it's less convenient than having a room to gather together in, Lord, we are thankful that we can still do this and we can still open your word together and read it together, God. And so we ask that you would speak to us this morning, that you would help us by your spirit to understand what you want to say to us, God. God, we want to be obedient to you. We want to know the truth. We trust you as a loving Father. We know that you love us. We know that you want to free us from things that will destroy us, God. You want to change our thoughts, God, from believing and trusting in things that will ruin us, God, and our relationships and our relationship with you, God. And you want to show us the truth so that we can be made whole and that we can have a relationship with you where our lives are changed for the better. And we can be raised to life in you, God, and that our lives can be used for your glory. And so we ask you to speak to us this morning. And may we hear from you, God. Give us wisdom and understanding. By your spirit, we pray. Amen. Amen. Okay, so 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 17, Paul wrote to the Corinthians. He says, "In the following directives, I have no praise for you, for your meetings do more harm than good." Okay? So this time Paul says, you know, he has no praise for them whatsoever. In the last section that we looked at last week on head coverings, you'll recall that Paul began by saying that he praised or commended them for their dedication to practices, okay, to practices, which really wasn't much praise at all because they weren't actually following what he had handed them. And they were missing, which we realize as he wrote further in that text, you know, he wasn't really praising them because his point was that they were missing the fact that God was actually head over all. And then in Christ, man and woman were equal, that there was no room based on the truth that God had revealed in Christ to use any type of practice to leverage power over the opposite sex, right? And so Paul was leading them to unity. But in this case, Paul says he has no praise for them. He just cuts to the chase. He says, "I have no praise for you at all." And his concern had to do with their meetings or their gatherings together. And he said that they did more harm than good. So when they gathered together as a church, it was actually damaging to the church. It was damaging. How so? Well, Paul went on to explain in verse 18. He said this. He said, "In the first place, I hear that when you come together as a church, there are divisions among you. And to some extent, I believe it. No doubt there have to be differences among you to show which of you have God's approval." And so Paul had heard through a messenger or through word of mouth that when the church gathered together, it wasn't good at all. I mean, as we've read so far, the Corinthian church was an absolute mess, right? I mean, these were people who were indulging in selfish ways. They were having relationships outside of marriage. They were having relationships they don't even really want to talk about, right? And so it was a mess. And Paul's like, you know what, when you come together even as a church, it's just not good. It's damaging. It's destroying the church. The more you come together, the worse things are getting. And understanding the meaning of the word church in this context, or actually in the New Testament, is pretty important. And the Greek word for church, again, I don't, you know, emphasize Greek too much. And I do believe that we can fully understand the gospel and the most important parts that God wants us to understand without going into Greek, but it is beneficial at times, right? And the Greek word for church is ekklesia, which is a compound word made up of words that mean out of and to call. So the church is a gathering of people. It consists of people who are called by God out of the world to come together or to assemble. So, you know, at dinner time, you know, when one of your kids is across the road at the park and another's in their room doing something, and your wife is working in the yard, or your husband is out in the garage doing something, and dinner's ready. And so you call everyone and you tell them to come from wherever they are to sit at the table or to assemble as a family, right? And nothing is more frustrating, right? When you finally sit down as a family, not that my family, I mean, I'm a pastor, so this would never happen in my family. We would never argue at the table. But nothing is more frustrating, right? When you assemble your family at the table to be one as a family and to celebrate being together, you know, and there's fighting and there's division that's happening at the table, right? But anyways, we'll get into that. But the church, when the church gathers, it's a community of people that have been called out of the world by God to assemble together as one family. But Paul's concern is that when the church came together, they were actually being torn apart. So as they were called out of the world and as they gathered together, there was division that was happening. They were being ripped apart in the time that they had together. And Paul said, to some extent, he could believe it or see how this could happen because, as he said, no doubt there has to be differences among them to show which of them have God's approval. And I used to read it differently, but it's not that it was God's will that there would be differences evident among them to show them who has his approval. But based on his understanding of their attitudes, meaning based on Paul's understanding of them, it's no doubt that this would happen because it's no doubt that they would insist on differences being evident among them so that people would see which of them has God's approval. Remember, these are people who were insistent on elevating themselves above other people, and they would use anything to do that. They were arrogant and they were trying to leverage power over people. And so Paul was addressing disunity among the church, and it didn't surprise him because he knew that there were people who felt the need to make differences between them obvious and to show which ones of them had God's approval. So they still cared that they had this appearance of spirituality. And this is the thing. I mean, people love to distinguish themselves from others in the world, and unfortunately in the church as well, to elevate themselves above other people spiritually. And this is what the Pharisees were like. They distinguished themselves from others in society through their actions and their attire even, so that people would know just how special they were, right? And it still happens today. I've had conversations with friends in churches where the leadership insists on sitting in chairs on stage during the service, separated and distinguished from the regular congregation. I've experienced backlash in churches that I've pastored in the past when we took away the gold badges that identified people, identified their positions as elders or board members. And we reissued those badges with generic badges that simply said volunteer, trying to represent that they were just there simply to serve. But there was backlash about that because people love to distinguish themselves, right? And make it evident how spiritual they are. And unfortunately, people will fight for that. They will fight for that. But in this case, people in the church in Corinth were doing something different to distinguish themselves. They didn't have gold badges that I know of. I don't know whether they had chairs for leaders on stage or whatever it might be, or on the platform. But Paul continued to talk about this in verses 20 to 22. Let's read it together. He says, so then, when you come together, it's not the Lord's Supper you eat. For when you are eating, some of you go ahead with your own private suppers. And as a result, one person remains hungry and another gets drunk. Don't you have homes to eat and drink in? Or do you despise the church of God by humiliating those who have nothing? What shall I say to you? Shall I praise you? Certainly not in this matter." All right, I would have read a few more verses. We went to verse, it's a 22, that's right. So one of the things that the church did when it came together was have a meal together called the Lord's Supper. Today we call it communion, and it only consists of a representative wafer or cracker and a thimble full of juice. But back then it was actually a meal, which the tradition began during the Jewish Passover when Jesus ate with his disciples before his crucifixion. But the way that people were distinguishing themselves in the church in Corinth, the way they were distinguishing themselves from others, and the issue that Paul was addressing was that they weren't eating the Lord's Supper as an entire church, okay? So instead, people who perhaps, I don't know if they had more control or took control, or maybe they were the ones who had money and they provided the resources, so they felt that they had the right to do so, but they went ahead and they had private meals, indulging themselves in food and drink to the point that they were just gluttonous. They would eat everything. They would drink to the point of drunkenness, consuming everything. And not only doing that, but excluding other people in the church and who would actually remain hungry, who didn't have access to what they had access to, okay? And so not only were they selfish in their consumption, it appears that they actually wanted others in the church to be and feel humiliated. So Paul continued with a passage that you're likely very familiar with. We read it, every month when we do communion together, and so we're going to read it again now. And the Green family, great job this morning. Green family, appreciate you guys reading it. They read this as well, and we're going to read it again. It starts at verse 23. And Paul wrote, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" So as I said before, this is a passage we read every month during communion, and there's a lot of value in the passage, but it actually wasn't written as a script for celebrating communion. Rather, Paul wrote these words to people in the church who were gluttonous and excluding and humiliating people by not including them in the Lord's Supper to remind them where the meal came from. But not only, so he says, "I receive from the Lord what I pass on to you." This isn't just a tradition that I've handed to you and something I've asked you to do. This is something that Jesus himself has given to me. I received it and I've passed it on to you. And so not only was he reminding them where that meal came from, where the tradition of that meal came from, but also what it represented. And the Lord's Supper wasn't simply a nice idea that Paul had come up with. It was something that Paul had received from Christ, and not only did he receive it from Christ, Paul said, Jesus took the bread and he said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do it in remembrance of me." And he said, "This is the cup, which is my blood that is poured out for you, and do it in remembrance of me." And even though his disciples wouldn't have fully understood what he meant at the time, Jesus meant at the time, Jesus was associating the bread and the wine of the Passover meal that he shared with them, with his broken body and shed blood that would actually take place shortly after when he gave his life up on the cross. His body was broken and his blood was shed to provide forgiveness for the sins of the world so that people, despite race, despite gender, despite position in society, despite their strengths, their weaknesses, their failures, they could all come together as one in him. And so Paul was showing the church in Corinth that the Lord's Supper was meant to be a reminder, not just a reminder as a reflection of, we're going to read this text and reflect on what Jesus did for us. But not only did Jesus associate that act of love with a meal, he asked his disciples to continue to consume the supper in remembrance of him, which didn't mean simply eating the meal because that's what Jesus told them to do or even eating the meal only to remember what Jesus did, but eating it in a way that reflected and honored what Jesus had done for them. He laid down his life so that they could have unity as God's children and live as one in him because of what he had done for them. And even though he was God in the flesh, God lowered himself to death on the cross so that lowly, broken, sinful people of the world could be forgiven and lifted up and come to know the love of God. But in the Corinthian church, remember, people were actually using the very meal that was intended to remember and represent the selfless love of Christ, which was meant to lead to unity, as a way to distinguish themselves above others and exclude people, leading to their humiliation. You can imagine how Christ would feel about that, which is why Paul continued to say this in verse 27. He said, "So then, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and the blood of the Lord." And this verse is, to be honest, it's taken out of context so often today, and we're going to chat about that later, but he wasn't making a point here about people who are and are not Christians and making sure that no one participates in the Lord's Supper if they haven't said the sinner's prayer or professed their faith. He's not saying that here, okay? And that is something that people interpret that to be referring to, and many churches around the world use this text to support that understanding or that belief. He's talking to people who have claimed to be devoted to Christ, who eat the meal in a way that denies him. The meal is meant to remember the self-sacrificing love of Christ, which leads to unity in a way that, and it was being used in a way that was selfish and led to division, right? And he's saying when you eat the meal in a manner that, you know, elevates yourself and puts other people down and leads to division, you're guilty of sinning against the body and the blood of Christ. Well, what is sin? To sin means to fall short. It means to miss the whole point, miss the mark. And so Christ's point was that this meal represented, so as they ate the food, ate the bread and as they drank the wine, it would remind them of what Christ had done for them in laying down power so that people could come together in unity. And also the meal represented that unity, that they were all at the same table because of what Christ had done. He's like, when you eat a meal that represents that and you do it to elevate yourself and humiliate people, you've missed the mark completely. You're sinning against the body and the blood of Christ. You are so far off track from God's intention for that meal, right? And so Paul continued by writing this in verses 28 to 30. He says, "Everyone ought to examine themselves before they eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For those who eat and drink without discerning the body of Christ eat and drink judgment on themselves." And Christ was always very, very firm about that. He's like, if you claim one thing and then intentionally deny me, then you are bringing judgment upon yourself because you actually know what you're called to do and you're intentionally living against it. And Paul goes on, he says, "For those who eat and drink without discerning the body of Christ," meaning they don't consider what this is all about and what Christ has done for them, "they eat and drink judgment on themselves. And that is why many of you are weak and sick, and a number of you have fallen asleep." He's not just talking about people falling asleep in church, which, you know, might happen if you're sitting under my teaching. But, you know, people, the words weak and sick here, we got to be careful here because weak and sick can mean, it can be interpreted two ways. It can be spiritual weakness and spiritual sickness and spiritually falling asleep, meaning you become blinded to the truth of the gospel. And it can actually mean physical sickness, and sleep can refer to death. And so we don't know exactly what he means here. And it's possible that it could be either one, but it should wake us up and make us take this seriously either way. He says, "But if we were more discerning with regard to ourselves, we would not come under such judgment. Nevertheless, when we are judged in this way by the Lord, we are being disciplined so that we will not be finally condemned with the world." With the world. So what Paul is saying is that they need to consider how their actions, specifically in this case, how they consumed the Lord's Supper and how they actually went about eating the meal, how it reflected upon the actions of Christ himself, which is what the meal was intended to reflect and remind them of, okay? And on top of that, Paul warned them that their lack of discernment is why many of them were going to face a discipline from God. But when God did discipline them, it was actually for their benefit again. So if they, whether it ended up being physical illness or whether it was spiritual illness and they ended up having problems in life because they weren't following the truth of God's word, and that always has an impact and consequence on our lives, in our relationships, in our identity, in the choices we make, all those types of things, whatever it might be, Paul's like, you know, that's God in his love disciplining you so that you wake up and realize that you've somehow gone off track, and it should point you back to, or, you know, encourage you hopefully to go back to Christ so that in the end, at least you'll live in relationship with God, okay? But either way, when things happen in a relationship, the idea is that it's meant to point, or sorry, when things happen in our lives, it's meant to point us back to God. But finally, Paul concluded this discussion in verse 33 by writing this. He says, "So then, my brothers and sisters, when you gather to eat, you should all eat together. And those who are hungry should eat something at home so that when you meet together, it may not result in judgment. And when I come, I will give further directions." And so Paul planned on going back to Corinth and speaking to them in person. And Paul's point in all of this was that the way the Lord's Supper was practiced in the Corinthian church, it must serve to accurately remember and reflect the love of Christ. And so when we read through this, the first thing we need to consider, first of all, is how this directly applies to us. Is this something that continues to occur today? And many of us would likely say or think, no, we make sure everyone gets a wafer and some juice, right? We put out an announcement earlier in the week to make sure people have something ready so that when we, you know, participate in communion together online, everyone's ready to go. But also when we read scripture, we also need to evaluate how we've traditionally used this passage in light of what's actually being said. Anytime we read scripture, we have to say, okay, the practices and the traditions and the understandings that we have in the church, do they even line up with the truth that is being revealed here, that God has revealed through Christ and then is being communicated through Paul? And there are really only a few ways that I've seen this passage used in the church throughout my life. First of all, it's been used as a reading, as we have, to reflect on what Christ told his disciples to do before being obedient and eating and drinking in remembrance of him, okay? And so we read it each month during communion, which is fine, I suppose. It's not taking the passage out of context. It's simply reading it in remembrance of Christ. But the thing is, using it only in this way doesn't consider the important principle behind what Paul is saying. And that's what happens sometimes too when we just take pieces of scripture and read them over and over again and we use them for something that we find them beneficial for, is unless we go back and do what we're doing with Corinthians, we don't actually become confronted by the overarching principle that we really need to be confronted with, okay? Well, another way that this passage is used is to encourage people, or I've seen it used in the church, is it's a passage that's used to encourage people to search their hearts before taking communion. And if there's any unconfessed sin, it should be confessed so that you don't participate in a holy meal and bring judgment upon yourself. And so growing up, you know, you would pray before you take communion, and you would search your heart and make sure that there's no hidden sin, because you didn't want God to condemn you or judge you if you happened to eat this holy meal. And there was almost this mystical idea that something about eating that wafer and drinking that juice, if you didn't deal with something in your heart, is going to bring judgment upon yourself. And while this is getting closer, and while it's important to search our hearts, I mean, scripture and God certainly calls us to search our hearts and confess our sins to him, and knowing that we'll be forgiven always, that his mercy is limitless, that's still not exactly what Paul was saying here. That understanding, it's almost as though our theology has been shaped more by Indiana Jones and the search for the Holy Grail than it has been by Christ. I don't know if you're familiar with that movie, but near the end, when both Indiana Jones and the villain, I think the villain actually, which is often the case, probably caught up to Indiana Jones and used him to get the treasure that he was looking after. They finally discovered a number of treasures which may have been the Lord's cup. And there were a number of different cups thought to bring eternal life. And the evil and arrogant villain went and he grabbed the cup and he drank first. He put himself first and he drank from a cup that was elaborately decorated, representing his pride and his materialism. And he was immediately cursed and died. And it's a bit of a graphic scene, so don't watch it with your kids. But you know, many people hold this type of almost mystical view of the Lord's Supper, that if you happen to go about it, and your motives are wrong, then you're going to bring on this like immediate judgment on your life. And again, we need to evaluate our hearts, but that's not what Paul was saying. It's not meant to just be this personal reflective thing, okay? And the last way that I've seen this passage used, and a way that continues to be used in many churches throughout the world, is as a warning to leaders and believers in the church. And again, as I say these, you're gonna know about them. You're gonna be familiar with them. You may even be influenced by these teachings, and you may even have convictions about these things, which is good to make sure that we're confronting our convictions and making sure they're rooted in truth. But it's been used for believers and leaders in the church to make sure that people that are new to the church, who haven't professed faith in Christ, don't participate in the Lord's Supper, lest they be judged or condemned by God. And again, to be fair, there are varying convictions that people hold. Some people feel it's important to emphasize this, before participating in communion, to emphasize the importance of being a follower of Jesus, so that someone who's in attendance might not, mistakenly eat the meal and bring judgment upon themselves. In other situations, there are churches who, unless you attend that church and are known as a believer, you are not welcome to be a part of that meal. Even if you're a believer from another church and you come in, you have to meet with the pastor before the service and profess your faith again to him in order to be granted access to the meal. But either way, there's an interpretation and an application of this passage that is really used to say, we need to make sure that someone who's not worthy, I suppose, someone who, they're basically saying, an unbeliever would be eating it in an unworthy manner, and they're going to bring judgment upon themselves, okay? But again, that is not what Paul is saying. Folks, the Lord's Supper is not a country club to celebrate being an insider. It's not about identifying a group of people who are God's people and then sipping some juice and eating a cracker together. Here's the thing. The text wasn't written. This text, you've read it with me. So you should be able to understand after reading, first of all, the context of Corinthians, knowing the gospel, and then reading through this as Paul has written it in its entirety, this text wasn't written as a warning to make sure unworthy people who don't know any better aren't permitted to participate in the Lord's Supper. It's not what it was written for. It was written to people who do know Christ, who know what he did for them, who were made worthy by Christ's sacrifice on the cross, and who did profess faith in Christ. This was written to and about people who did know better, yet who used the very meal that was intended by Christ to represent and remind people of the sacrifice he made to make unworthy people worthy and unite them together as one in him. It was written to people who knew better and professed to be people of Christ, yet used that very meal to exclude people and elevate themselves above others. It was written to people who were trying to keep people separated and elevate themselves as being more spiritual than other people. And that's what Paul meant by eating in an unworthy manner. Their practices, specifically eating the Lord's Supper in this case, it contradicted what the meal represented. Their actions were anti-Christ. And I won't focus on this too much, but you can say that the Lord's Supper is only for believers. And I understand that someone who doesn't understand what Christ has done for them won't understand the significance of the meal. But what I do know, and this is not the main point of this, so I'm not arguing for this, but what I do know from the gospel is that there was always a place for sinners at the table with Jesus. And anyone who sincerely desired to be close to Jesus was welcomed by Jesus, and they were made worthy by Jesus. All that's required is a desire for people to be present at the table with Jesus, okay? And we won't get into the number of examples where Jesus welcomed people. And in fact, it was the religious people who hated Jesus because of that, because Jesus showed, had fellowship with people that wanted to come close to him, but, you know, were sinners. And anyways, we won't get into that any further. But apart from evaluating how we consume the Lord's Supper, which is the first direct application, okay, there's a broader and I believe very appropriate application for us as a church based on this practice or based on this passage today, okay? And it's not only the Lord's Supper, which is meant to be a remembrance of and reflection of what Christ has done. Every time that we come together, every time we gather together, we are people who have been called out of the world by God, and we've come to understand what he's provided for us in Christ. And we've been called out of the world to give our lives to Christ, right? And to live in community with one another as an example of Christ's mercy and his love. We are many. We are all unworthy and broken pieces who have been made worthy only through Christ's self-sacrifice. And we're called to come together as one in him, male, female, young, old, every race, rich or poor. It doesn't matter who you are. We are all called by Christ to come together as one in him. And our value comes from Christ, who didn't try to hang on to his value, but made himself nothing so that we could be raised to life in him, all right? And Jesus is our nourishment. And so as we come together, right, and we consume the mercy and the truth that God's provided for us in Christ, as we gather online and we read scripture, right, we have life. He nourishes us. And that's why we gather together to read his word. But do you think Christ will be pleased with us when we come together only to consume his word for ourselves, to sit in a chair and just focus on what we can get, to listen and to hear for ourselves without any regard for those around us in the church who might be hurting, who might be broken, who might be struggling or weak among us? I can't see how this doesn't apply to us as well and hold us accountable. And yes, we don't gather in a room, but when we gather in a room together, so often it's all about, you know what, remove as many distractions so that I can get what I need today. You know, I need to pull myself up to the buffet and consume, you know, spiritual nourishment while I'm here, right? And I think Paul would say to us today, I think he'd say, like, listen, can't you do that at home? Don't you have a Bible at home? Can't you, you know, Christ called us to abide in him, to feed on his word every day. You know, he taught us to pray, give me today my daily bread. Christ taught that he is our daily bread. You know, wouldn't Paul say, can't you do that at home? Why don't you open your Bible and read throughout the week and grow and be nourished every week so that you're not just, you know, starving when you get here on Sunday morning? Yes, and we come and we open God's word together, but you know, when we're together as one, why don't we take advantage of that and make sure we use that opportunity to love and to care for one another and to be aware of someone else who might be in need and who might not know Christ in the way that we do, that we can actually share what we have with them. That is what the church of Christ is meant to be. That is why Christ gave his life up for us, so that we could come together and give our lives up for one another and not to be people who are consumers, who see the church as a place that is meant to meet all of our individual needs, right? That is what Christ gave his life for. And if we ever come to be a place where we just consume spiritual knowledge or a worship experience or whatever it might be, without considering how we can love and care for others among us, then we've failed to accurately reflect the one who brought us together. And so online, that's more challenging, isn't it? It's challenging, right? It's challenging because, you know, we are a screen where we come and we open our lives up to the word of God. And so that means we have to be even more diligent in times like this to remember why we even gather together online. It's not just so that we can be filled ourselves. We gather online and we open God's word so that we can become more like Christ. And my hope is, and I know what Christ's purpose for you is that in giving his life up, we would become people who would give up our lives. And after we sit here on the screen and we open God's word and we learn more about Christ, then we turn and maybe immediately after you would call someone and check in on them and see how they're doing. Maybe if you know someone who's struggling, you would take a meal over to them to encourage them, right? You would write a letter of encouragement, send an email, shoot off a text, okay? Whatever it might be, when we come together to eat of God's word, we have to make sure that our actions reflect what it is that Christ gave his life up for, okay? Let us not be people who simply consume and look out for ourselves. And I'm not saying you're doing it to elevate yourself spiritually over another. I mean, we have to consider that. We have to consider that when it comes to the Lord's Supper. We need to think about the implications on that. But on the broader level, every single thing that we do, nothing in itself is meant to just be a ritual that reminds us of Christ, what Christ has done. Everything we do is meant to remind us of what Christ has done, and it's meant to be done in a way that actually reflects the character of Christ, whether that's communion or just simply gathering together as a church to sing songs, okay? And which is why I'm really excited about the Christmas season right now. Our team has been wrestling with this, the leadership team, the staff has been wrestling with this, and I'm excited about the Christmas season because we're challenging ourselves to consider ways that we can try to include people multi-generational in the church experience itself so that kids aren't just like, well, here's a video to watch. And so throughout the Christmas season, part of our service is going to be focused on the kids. You know, I'm going to get to do a craft with kids on Sunday mornings together so that the kids understand that they are valued as well, okay? And that's just one area. And the goal of this isn't for you to start thinking, okay, well, what are you going to do for me? We're missing the whole point then. You know, this isn't about us. We need to all be thinking about how we can serve others in the church to make sure all people are loved and included and valued, all right? So as Christine leads us in this last song, let's be people who reflect on that and say, God, make us more like you. May our hearts and our actions reflect the selfless love that you revealed to us and you provided for us in your Son. And may we become like that in everything we do as a church, because that is who we have been called out of the world to be. All right, let's reflect on that right now as Christine leads us one more time, sing along, praise God for who he is, and then we'll come back and pray together before we go.
Hey, Hillspring Church, I'm so glad that you could join us online this morning. My name is Christine, for those of you who don't know me yet. And why don't you join with me in this last song this morning? Let's sing it together. This is my desire to honor you. Sing this out. This is my desire to honor you, Lord, with all my heart, I worship you. I give have your way in me. Lord, I give you my heart, give you my soul. I live for you alone. Every breath that I take, every moment time together. Lord, I give you my heart. Lord, I give you my heart. I give my soul. I live for you alone. Every breath that I take, every moment I'm away.
So glad that Christine picked that song. I mean, there really couldn't be a more appropriate and profound song based on what we're talking about. I mean, Lord, I give you my heart. I live for you alone. Have your way in me. You know, every breath I take, every moment I'm awake. But think about it. That is huge, because what we're saying is, God, I lay my life down for you. I will lower myself for your benefit. I will love other people, and I will lift other people above, or I will consider other people above myself when we gather together as a church and throughout my life, right? So that is the true heart of what it means to be a follower of Christ. And we just need to make sure that we're people who not only sing the words of those songs, but live them out. And I want to clarify, I mean, I'm not applying this to chastise you guys as a church. In fact, I celebrate you guys. I'm thankful for you. I am so thankful that you do consider others above yourselves so often. And so many of you have been, especially through COVID and all the stuff that's been going on, considering other people. But we always have more to grow, more room to grow. We always will be challenged, and our human nature will always want to take over, and we'll want to protect ourselves and consider ourselves above other people. And this should challenge us just to remember that we need to continue to be devoted, even through the worst of times, to not just come together as a church and consume, but to be people who are selfless and who lay our lives down for one another, just like Christ laid down his life for us. And man, if an unbeliever, someone who's new to faith, if you're maybe just checking this out for the first time, I know that's life, that's impactful, you know, that reflects who Christ actually is. And if you don't know Christ, that is a true reflection of who God is. God is a God who loves you, who gave his son for you, so that even if you don't feel you have value, yeah, no matter who you are, where you've come from, God welcomes you to himself. He forgives your sins, and he wants to bring you together with others under his son, Christ, in unity. That's who God is. He loves you, and I want you to know that. So let's pray, and let's just ask God to continue to lead us as a church to be more like Christ in everything we do before we go. God, we thank you so much for your word. And I thank you for everyone who has taken the time to gather together online this morning, Lord. I thank you for everyone's faithfulness to each other. Even it is dedication to continue meeting together, Lord, even when it's different and it's been going on for a long time. But God, I pray that as we open your word, and I pray that as we seek your truth, God, that it wouldn't just be words that we hear. It wouldn't just be something we learn about a church a couple thousand years ago. But we would see the truth in this, and that it would sink deep into all of our hearts, God, and change who we are. God, we want to be people whose gatherings and whose practices are not empty or self-serving. God, we want to be people who are used by you to reflect all that you've done for us through your Son. And so use our lives for that, God, we pray. Lead us by your Spirit. Be people who are shaped by your truth, we ask in your holy name. Amen. Amen. Thanks so much for gathering together with me online today, everyone. Hope you're doing well. And again, always reach out if you need to be in touch. If you you need to chat, if you need someone to pray for you, don't ever hesitate to shoot me an email or send me a text. The number is going to be up on the screen in just a moment. I'd love to be able to connect with you, grab a Zoom call, and just check in. So don't ever hesitate to do that. I love you guys. We'll talk to you soon. Take care. Bye.